performance, and you're not here to be passive and just consume church. When church is on the screen, it can be really tempting to just sit and consume. But we're here to gather together as one family. And I hope this will be a time of communal worship together. As humans, we're made to be in community, to be in family, and it's so important that we come to Jesus together. We come to praise God together, and that's for our good and for his glory. So please do join us now, whether you're sitting here or whether you're at home eating your breakfast. Welcome.
Yeah, big welcome from me. Hello, everybody. We're in our series in Acts, which we've been in for a while, and today we're looking at this all-nighter, this communion service in a place called Troas, starring the Apostle Paul and his traveling team, and Dr. Luke, who was with them and who wrote the stories, and a young teenager called Eutychus, who has a starring role. Lots to look forward to, and we're going to take communion together, so hopefully you can have, if you're at home, some bread and some wine near you.
So please have that ready for about 30 minutes' time. We really want to feel like one family together, so please, if you're at home, please do text in and answer this question. When have you felt most energized recently? The number is on your screens. In this moment, we're together, and there are lots of things which can distract us and demand our attention, I think especially if you're at home. So let's focus on Jesus. Let's remind ourselves afresh of why we're here and who it is we're worshipping. If this is new for you, we're really, really glad that you can join us. Perhaps you've been watching church online, or perhaps you've come back to church after some time of being away. Do you take this opportunity, as Tom leads us in songs, to soak in the truths which we're going to sing and say in the church service. Thanks, Tom.
Thanks, Rachel. Good morning, everybody. It's great to see you all here in person, and great that you can join us at home. As Rachel said, we're going to sing together now, or at least I am, for you guys here in the building, and you guys at home, you can sing. So do stand at home and sing along and go for it. You guys here, I really feel for you not being able to sing. It's odd for me as well, being up here with you not being able to sing. But can you guys stand as well now? And can I encourage you that you can be worshiping now, even though you can't sing? If you're the type of person who maybe doesn't usually use your hands in worship, whether that's putting them in the air or clapping, what better time to do that than now when you can't do anything else? Let's go for it. Let's worship Jesus together, whether we're here or whether we're at home.
Come and stand before your Maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold his power and glory, yet with confidence draw near. For the one who holds the heavens and commands the stars above is the God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of our praise. Rejoice! Sing of mercies of our King, and we trembling rejoice. We are children of the promise, the beloved of the Lord, one with everlasting kindness, bought with sacrificial blood, bringing reconciliation to a world that longs to know the affections of a Father who will never let them go. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Rejoice! Sing sickness, all our sorrows, Jesus carried up the hill. He has walked this path before us, He is walking with us still. Turning tragedy to triumph, turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. Rejoice, when you cry to Him, He hears your voice. He will wipe away your tears. Rejoice, in the midst of suffering, He will help you sing. Rejoice, come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of our praise. Rejoice, sing the mercies of your King.
Hallelujah. Do take a seat.
So, as Chris said, we're going to be looking at a story from Acts this morning. And this is another story from Paul's missionary journeys around Turkey and Greece. So we are going to be looking at a story from a place called Troas, which you can see on the slides, on the screen behind me if you're here in the service. Troas is a place which Paul's been to a couple of times. We first heard about it in Acts 16, and that's a place where Paul had a vision in the night from Macedonian saying, come out and help us. And Paul actually changed his plans from Troas. He's now back in Troas and has been there for a week talking and living with the people and teaching about Jesus. And this is his final night there. So they're staying in a big house, and they've gathered together to eat and to listen to Paul. In Jewish custom at that time, sharing communion and eating would have been something which happened together. So you can imagine an audience who are quite hungry and are eagerly listening to Paul and awaiting their meal together. We hear about Troas again in 2 Timothy, and we find out that Paul left his cloak there and some parchment and some scrolls. So perhaps that was on this occasion. He was somewhat distracted. So the Cunningham family are going to read us our story from the Bible, which is from Acts 20.
Acts 20, 7 to 12. On the first day of the week, we came to break bread. Paul spoke to the people, and because he intended to leave the next day, kept on talking until midnight. There were many lamps in the upstairs room where they were meeting.
Seated in a window was a young man named Eutychus, who was sinking into a deep, deep sleep as Paul talked on and on.
When he was sound asleep, he fell to the ground from the third story. He was picked up.
Dead!
Paul went down and threw himself on the young man and put his arms around him.
Don't be alarmed, he said. He's alive.
Then he went upstairs
again and broke bread and ate. After talking until daylight, he left the people, took the young man home alive, and were greatly comforted.
Wow, fab. So we've been in a series in Acts for some time now, not following chronologically, but looking at how the early church loved and served each other in September. And our home group material also picked up on that as we looked at the church loving and serving each other. And in October, our focus is on how the early church were meeting with God. And similarly, in our home group material, we're looking at practices that help us in our relationship with God. So Troas, near ancient Troy, was the peaceful setting for this memorable communion service which is described in the verses that we just read. And when Paul arrived, he got reunited with his team, a big team, including people from lots of different places where he had been ministering, Sopater of Berea, Aristarchus and Secundus from Thessalonica, Gaius from Derbe, and Timothy and Trophimus from Asia. So these were some of the team that were gathering in this home of Carpus, and it was the first day of the week. Now, we're not sure whether actually that was a Saturday night or a Sunday night, because the Jewish day starts in the evening. But whenever it was, everyone wanted to listen to the Apostle Paul and the word of God that he was bringing. And like us this morning, Paul did his teaching in two parts. The first part was from sunset to midnight, and the next part was from midnight till sunrise. So if I go on a bit, no complaints, right? Now, there was a young man, probably a teenager, whose spirit was willing, but whose flesh was weak and tired. And we read about that in verse 9. Seated in a window was a young man named Eutychus, who was sinking into a deep sleep as Paul talked on and on. And when he was sound asleep, he fell to the ground from the third story, and Dr. Luke said he was picked up dead. But they didn't mourn for long. Paul went down in the manner of Elijah and Elisha and threw himself on the young man and put his arms around him. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "He's alive." So this event, this extraordinary event, didn't diminish their focus on God. As he was brought up alive, they were encouraged, and they continued to hang on Paul's every word as he taught them. And then as they celebrated the resurrection at breakfast, as we're going to do by taking the bread and the wine and communion with God together. Now, I actually have deep sympathy for people who have trouble staying awake in church. A lot of people, even like Rachel this week, has been working nights and late shifts, have worked long hours, and when you sit down, it can feel like the first time that you've sort of sat down to relax in the week. Others I know take a lot of medication and can fall victim to that. I did hear of an elder who fell asleep during a sermon and was snoring in the evening service, and his wife gave him a not-so-subtle dig in the ribs, and he stopped his snoring, and he stood up and he pronounced the benediction right there in the middle of the sermon. But some people are actually asleep spiritually because they've never been awake. Their focus is actually on other things, whether it be work or family or sport, hobbies, politics, whatever. Others are asleep because their faith is second-hand. They come to church because it's what they've always done, or maybe because parents have brought them to church, but they don't have an individual relationship with God. Spiritually, they're yet to wake up. Others are asleep because from the moment they wake up, they're distracted with social media, with their phones, with technology. If your calendar says 2020, this is probably you in part. It is of me in many cases. In Revelation chapter 3, the Lord Jesus addresses a church in Sardis, and he says, "Wake up! You have the reputation of being alive, but actually you're dead." Others are asleep because they're more like the church in Ephesus, also described in Revelation chapter 2, where they've drifted from their first love. Like Samson, who slept in the lap of Delilah as she cut off all his hair, they're asleep because they've lost their focus on God, their first love. Now, it's not uncommon for any of us in our Christian lives to have a time where we lose focus on God, where we drift, where we backslide. That happens to probably almost all of us at some point in our Christian lives. But others are asleep because spiritually and emotionally they're exhausted and battered. Now, if any of these categories describes you, if you look back on recent weeks, days, months, and think, actually, you know, I've been in a spiritual slumber, and I need to wake up. I need to renew my first love. I need to come back and to focus on God and His Word and His people and His mission. I would like to pray, and I would like to invite you at home and in this congregation, if you feel, yeah, you know, I want to renew my commitment to God. I have been spiritually in a slumber. I would like to invite you to stand at home or in this congregation. And I am the first here to stand. This describes me. I have at times lost my focus. It's been very, very hard not to meet, to worship, to have that spiritual injection of being with God's people. So I'd like to invite you to stand, and I'm going to pray for you right now. Father God, I want to pray that you would restore to us the joy of your salvation and renew a right spirit within us. As Paul writes to the Ephesians, wake up, O sleeper, and rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Lord, I pray that you would restore our zeal and spiritual hunger this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Do stay standing here and at home. We're going to use a song to worship the Lord together now, and there's going to be actions to this song. The chorus says, you've created me to worship you. You've created me to love you, and you've made me to delight in you. As Chris was sharing, it's been easy to forget that over the past few months. So let's use this song. Let's use the actions, especially if we can't sing together in the room. And let's worship Jesus together. Blood for Have a seat.
So our sort of topic this morning is meeting and communing with God. And in the early churches, what we see is this pattern of intentional focus on God together. And right from the very early days, the early church in Jerusalem, in chapter 2, devoted themselves, we read. Oh, I forgot my clicker. Can you click it onto that slide? Sorry. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. This is the Spirit-filled church. This is the day of Pentecost, or the aftermath of, and where the Holy Spirit reigns. A love for God's word reigns, a hunger for God's word. And we saw that, didn't we, in this all-nighter in Troas, hunger for God's word. Peter says in his first letter that we should crave spiritual milk so that by it we can grow up. And Bible teaching was very much the milk of the early church. And you know, we too, we mustn't despise Bible teaching. Jesus said to us, man cannot live on bread alone. He needs every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And Bible teaching, meditation on scripture, is the means by which we receive this milk and by which we grow up. So we need to crave the right things or we're going to fall asleep spiritually. I wonder what your deep cravings are, your hopes and dreams are right now, and mine. We see in the early church that they craved this spiritual milk. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. They also devoted themselves to the fellowship, or koinonia, the Greek word is in the New Testament. And we see that in this story in Troas, as the people experienced fellowship, koinonia, with the Father and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, they experienced deep fellowship with each other. Real practical, down-to-earth Christian fellowship. And I guess in recent weeks and months, we have really missed this, haven't we? And I join John in an apology that, you know, we didn't get things going perhaps as quick here in terms of gathering as we might have. But you know, even more important than what we do as a gathered church in this building is what we do as a scattered church in our homes and our workplaces. And actually, to grow as a Christian and to grow in our communion with God, we do need certain disciplines in our lives, privately and in community, or we're going to fall asleep spiritually. I've been increasingly convinced recently that we all need some kind of mentor in our lives, and we need to look to mentor others. That I think this is what devoting yourself to the fellowship can involve, especially in this time of the rule of six. You know, we can meet with one other person, and have the discipline in our lives of having at least one vulnerable conversation a week with somebody. You know, some of us can go weeks and weeks without having that vulnerable conversation, which is authentic, in which we confess our sins. I think if we stop doing that, we're going to stop growing and fall asleep. So I wonder, could you mentor somebody, get alongside somebody who is younger than yourself in the faith? That would be one way to devote yourself to the koinonia and to build in Above Bar Church this culture of discipleship despite the rule of six that we have. They also devoted themselves to the breaking of bread. I think this was the remembering of the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. I'm sure they had a communal meal together as well. And they devoted themselves to prayer, both communally and privately. And these regular routines and practices are given to the church to keep us awake spiritually. So for us, we need, if we are to keep going in our Christian lives, to have private practices like Jesus, who went to quiet places and spent time alone with the Lord. And we need corporate practices like meeting up with somebody to have that vulnerable conversation, to study the Bible, to pray. Small groups are also good for that. And I've put on the table here, I think, quite a useful handout for parents to help you to pray with your children during dinner time and bedtime. They're not long, laborious things. There's fun things. There's like tickle prayers and things like that. I'd love you to take it on your way out. I've also just read a book called The Common Rule, which encourages a kneeling prayer three times a day. So before you switch on your phone, you kneel and you commit the day to God. Midday at work, whether it's in your suit, your work clothes, whatever, you have a few minutes where you kneel in the presence of God and at bedtime. I've found that a helpful practice, actually, myself over the past few months. But of course, one practice that Jesus has given us communally is the Lord's table. And I would like to invite you now to do what the Apostle Paul encourages us to do, which is to examine ourselves and to think, what have I been craving? What am I craving right now? What am I devoting myself to? Is it to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to prayer? Or have I been slumbering spiritually? Well, I'm sure that we've all struggled spiritually and emotionally during this time. But perhaps you can use this time of communion, this time of a covenant meal together and with the Lord, to commit yourself again to Him and His people with all our faults and our failings and our sins. This is what God wants us to do right now. And perhaps you could pray where you are for an encounter with Him. And if you've been struggling with church, a renewed love for His people. Over to Rachel. To you, sorry, to Tom.
I'm not Rachel. Just before we come to communion together, we're going to use another song to worship the Lord together. So shall we stand both here and at home? It's a song that might be new to some of you, but it speaks of what the Lord Jesus has achieved for us. So let's use these words to reflect on that as we come to Him and as we come to communion together. Let's worship.
The mystery of the cross I cannot comprehend, the agonies of Calvary, you the perfect holy. a cup reserved for me. Your blood has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you.
Jesus. Amen. Amen. Do be seated.
Thank you, Tom. The communion, one of the purposes of communion is to inject energy and passion and zeal into our relationship with God. We asked a question at the beginning, which some of you have been texting in, about when you feel most energized recently. So I'll just share some answers from home. The Zulis say they're energized by some wonderful hill walking in the Lake District recently. God indeed is an amazing creator. Someone else says they feel energized when they're dancing. And Noah and Lottie, who did the reading for us, feel very energized as a family when they get outside. It's wonderful. They're powerful words which we've just sung about coming to the Lord's table, and we are indeed welcome to his table. As we come to share communion together, let's think again about those questions that Chris asked us. What are you devoting yourself to? What and have you been asleep recently, spiritually? Note that it's not until Eucharist is restored that they all break bread together. God is inviting you to his table. spiritually inviting you into his presence and to enjoy communion with him. Communion implies that the Lord's Supper is an act of participation with Christ. It's an act of communion. It's a relational act. And meals are often like that, aren't they? When you invite someone for dinner, you're not just inviting them to eat food, you're inviting them to enjoy friendship. And communion is an invitation to enjoy friendship and experience Christ's presence. Chris encouraged us to pray on our knees, and it's often true that actually the physical posture which we adopt is helpful for us as we connect with God. We can talk a lot about Christ being present, but what does that actually mean when we're having communion? How can eating bread and drinking wine be an act of communion with Christ? Well, Christ is present by the Holy Spirit. He's not physically present, but he's spiritually present. He's present by the Spirit. And he's here to reassure us of his love, of his protection, and his commitment. The bread and the wine are physical signs of his spiritual presence. Jesus promises us that he's present with us all the time by his Spirit. But in his kindness, he gives us these physical signs of his presence. Because of his body being sacrificed on the cross and his blood, a sign of the new covenant with the relationship with God, in eating the bread and drinking wine, we're declaring with our actions that we believe the chorus which we've just been singing or saying. That chorus was, "Your blood has washed away my sin, the Father's wrath completely satisfied. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. By your perfect sacrifice, I've been brought near. Jesus, thank you." God is inviting you to his table. He's inviting you spiritually into his presence and to enjoy communion with him. Do you want to accept that invitation? So if you're joining us from home, please do have your bread and wine ready. As we gather together at the table, let us examine ourselves and say sorry to God for the ways in which we've sinned, the ways in which we've put ourselves and others and other things before God. Please join me. Father God, we admit that we've turned against you in our thoughts, in our words, and in our actions. We've hurt you and we've hurt others. We're sorry, Father, and we turn back to you. Have mercy on us. Thank you that because of Jesus' death on the cross, we can receive your forgiveness and have peace in our relationship with you. Amen.
Well, Luke, who also wrote a gospel, describes the Last Supper, and his account is in Luke chapter 22, and it goes like this. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, "I've eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took the bread and he gave thanks and he broke it. And then he gave it to them and he said, "This is my body that is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks and he said, I've lost my reading. "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." So in front of you, you have a little container. We're going to take the bread and the wine together. Maybe dip the wafer into the wine. everything is different about the way we're doing church at the moment, and kind of weird. But God never changes, and our faith is based on the fact that Jesus died and is risen. He's taken our sins away. He's conquered death. That means that everything sad is going to become untrue. It means that there is going to be ultimate reconciliation for this world. Everything filthy and wrong in it is going to be fixed. And Jesus and his people will reign. And we celebrate that together. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for dying for us. Thank you for absorbing the sin that we have committed and continue to commit against you. Thank you that it is nailed to the cross and forgiven, and that we are cleansed through faith and trust in you. Thank you that everything that is broken, including us, will be fixed, and a great restoration, reconciliation, and resurrection is in store for this whole world, including us. In this unusual way of doing this for us, we celebrate. We look back to what you've done for us, and we look forward to what you will do for this world and for your people. In your precious name, we thank you. Amen. Could you take this and put it somewhere in the rubbish as you leave, rather than just leave it? Thank you.
Well, we're coming towards the end of our service together this morning, and we're going to use a song together to close. Just a reminder as well, before we use this song, that another way that we respond to all that God has done for us and that we worship is with our finances. And that can feel a little bit odd to insert into a service, or it can sometimes, I don't know, when people say things about money from the front, it can feel like we're twisting your arm or something like that. But we're really not, and we really do believe that we want to worship God with all that we have. And so take this opportunity over the next song to think about how you're using your finances. I need to do that as well. If you give already, use this next song to commit that to the Lord and to bring that to him. If you don't yet give to Above Bar, but you're a regular here, a member here maybe, then maybe take this opportunity to think about how you might be able to give. And you can find info about that on the church website. But let's stand together. Let's worship Jesus, whether we're here or whether we're at home. Let's stand and worship him.
Worship our King. Come, let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how his love overcomes. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, and amen. You will do great things. Oh God, you do great things. chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awakened alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things.
Have a seat.
Please join me as we pray. We are going to pray for Peter and Kate Nolson, who are working in Spain, and we've got a video update from them. So let's watch that together first.
Hello from Spain.
Really nice to be with you in the Above Our Church family for this morning's service. Could be the evening service, we really don't know. We'd like to talk to you about our situation here in Spain, southern Spain, and these are some of the things that we've got on our minds. We want to hand over the work that we've got here. We want other people leading the services, taking part in the preaching. I'm also involved in looking after the books, so we'd just love to find somebody who will be able to take over looking after the books, the offerings and such like. And we need to be encouraging people to be using their gifts.
Yeah, we really want people to feel that they know what the gifts they have from God and that they're willing to use them in the church.
And then, of course, we also want people to be using their testimony. We have got groups, families in four different towns. We'd love to see them using their testimony to reach out not only to their own family, but also to their neighbours. So please pray for us that we would have a real impact on the people who are around us.
Thanks for praying. Hello from Spain.
Hello from Southampton. Wonderful. Let us pray together. Father, we thank you that in a world of uncertainty and change, we can find shelter and rest in your love. And be confident in your unchanging nature. You are a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding with loyal love and faithfulness. Thank you that we can join together this morning to celebrate you and to thank you for forgiving us and welcoming us into your presence. Father, I pray for my brothers and sisters that they'll find comfort in your love and encouragement from being united with Christ. Particularly, I pray for those who feel they're sleeping spiritually, those who feel that they're in a time of darkness, perhaps feeling exhausted with life, maybe burdened by physical or mental illness. Through your Spirit, refresh them. Thank you that through Jesus' death and resurrection, you come near to us. I pray, God, that we'll come close to you, trusting you more this week. And submitting to your will. Oh, Father, we thank you for the Nolsons. Thank you for their continued faithfulness to you through times of clarity and through times of uncertainty. Father, we pray for renewed zeal for the work that you've called them to do. We pray for those who they work with, members of their church. And God, we do pray that each of those members will be using their testimony to share with their neighbours, their friends and their family the miracle which you've done in their lives. We pray these things in your precious name, Lord Jesus. Amen. So I think we have now reached the end of our service. Anyone else want to add anything else? Okay. Thank you very much for joining us from home. Enjoy the rest of your day, and we look forward to welcoming you here in person if you're able at some point soon. Thank you very much.